So we'll continue from here. So that's fine. So EMP ID name is going to be a character value. Department is a character variable. Region is character variable. Salary is merit. And designation is character. Okay? That's great. So these are the seven observations that are there. So let me just put this into country library for time being. Okay, so let's just run this and see how well this works. Great. So now there are six variables and seven observations in this data set, right? Yeah. So the first variable is EMP ID, which is numeric, that's perfectly fine. Employee name, that's also fine. Department. Do you see some problem with the department?
No, I don't see anything.
Sorry?
No problem.
Okay, I'll just show you the code again. Just see what is there in the code.
DPT.
Okay. And let's go to the data set.
I think the home science character length.
Yeah, so you see the home science has not been read completely, right? So in your data, while you're trying to re-input it, you're given complete home science, right? Mm-hmm. But what it's displaying here is just HOMASCIE. NCE is not there.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll come back to see how we'll have to deal with this problem, okay? And then after that, region looks fine. So does salary and designation.
Mm-hmm.
Correct? So if you see, there's a similar problem with assistant also. There is no key.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Correct?
Mm-hmm.
So do you see some pattern there?
It's just left alignment.
No, not alignment exactly. So basically, by default, when you're trying to input the values using this particular method, by default, the character variable will take only 8 characters.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so anything that's more than 8 has been truncated. So, but this, you don't have to worry about this because as we discussed that, you know, we'll not be doing this way. We'll be importing data sets, correct? So you don't have to be concerned about it, but this is like a general rule that you need to keep in mind, like in case of your certification and all, you know, such questions might come. So when you're trying to input the values using data lines, by default, the character variable will take only 8 characters when you do not specify the length of it.
Okay.
So we have obviously not specified the length and it's taking only 8. So anything that's more than 8 will get it truncated. Okay. So let's see how do we deal with the length issue that we have at hand. Okay. So what do you have to do for that is there are different ways of dealing with it, but for currently for time being, what we can do is we can use a length statement. Length and give the variable name. The variable name is department. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And specify the length. Let's say it's 12 dot. So it has to end with a dot. So you give the variable name with the data type or with the character, and you give the length of it with a period at the end. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how we specify a length. Okay, and it has length has to be specified before your input statement in this particular case, because that is how this that is a syntax rule. If you place it after it, it will not work. It will not give you an error, but the length will not get adjusted.
Okay, can you repeat the statement, please?
The thing is, a length statement here has to be given before your input statement.
Oh, okay.
You can't give it after your interpreting.
Okay.
Okay. So let's just rerun this. So here you see it's fine now, especially department, but it's coming in the beginning. It's coming before your EMP ID.
Yeah.
For a reason, because if you read length first.
Okay.
Right, and then the input the values that are there in the input statement. Okay, so similarly for designation also let us give designation. So now
you have missed a character.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. So here department and designation are going to come in the beginning, then the rest of them. That's because we're using the length statement. But there are different ways of doing it also. Like for example, you don't want to give your designation here. Okay. And you want to specify it here at the end, you can do that also. But then there are certain rules that need to be kept in mind while doing that. So don't have to worry about it right now. There's a topic called as INFILE which we'll be doing very soon. So you will be you're getting into the details of it there. Okay. So now I have the next question for you. That is, let's add one more value here called as date of joining. That is DOJ. So now DOJ must have values like this. The way like this is the date of joining of each of these employees. Okay. So let's say the date of joining here is 12/42/14, you know, and then just give a space here. /14/14. Okay, so these are the date values that I want to enter. Okay, so this is like date, month, and year, right? So can you just write a code for this? The way I've written, they can put the name for the input, your input statement, and put in those values and try and run it. Can you do that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
it is showing me some error.
Okay, what's that error? Is it share screen?
I'll just share my screen. Yeah, sure.
Sai, you can just put into, temporary library.
Can you see mine?
Not yet.
Dot? Is it dot?
No, I can't see your screen. Actually, it's just blacked out. Yeah, now it's better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just got a dot.
Okay, so you got a dot, is it?
That's
so,
right.
Yeah, exactly. So then don't worry, it's fine. I'll tell you why. See, the thing is, let me also execute at mine and let's see. So, let me just run this code. I don't have an error in my log, right? It says everything is read properly.
Yeah.
But in my output, I don't have a value there. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just having a period. I'm having a dot in place of date values. Can anybody guess why is that happening?
Flash.
Exactly. So why that's happening is because it's just not a pure numeric value. It has got a special character into it. So how do we deal with this now? So let's see what happens if we declare this as a character. Okay. So I'm just put a dollar symbol in front of the DOJ and I'm going to run it. Sorry. Yeah. So now you see my DOJ value is populated.
Okay.
Right? But is this a solution to my problem?
It can be, right?
Yeah, as of now you see, yes, the problem is solved. The date values are appearing. So that's perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm.
But, okay, if I ask you now, Anusha, can you tell me that for each of the employees, how many days has it been since their joining till date? Right? So in that case, what you'll have to do from current date to the date of joining, you have to find the difference. Right?
Yes, yes.
So only then will you find the number of days. Correct. But now since this value of date is stored as character, you can't do any mathematical operation on that.
Yes.
Right? So internally, it's just nothing but ABC. So you can't do any math stat operation on that. So technically, we are still the problem is not being solved, right? So what we have to do is just remove the dollar symbol there first of all.
Hello.
Yeah. Hello. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, Anusha.
Hear you. I cannot hear. I'll go somewhere else and try. Just a minute.
Oh,
sorry for the inconvenience.
No problem.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you continue?
Yeah. Thank you.
No problem. So the thing is, we have to do something in order to read these numeric values which have got a special character in it. So these are called as non-standard data. This is not a standard numeric data, right? So it's called non-standard. In order to read values like this, we have a statement called as in format. So what exactly does this in format do? So in format statement or string format help to read non-standard data into the system. So what is meant by that is, now there was something that the system was not able to recognize, correct? Because of a special character, these numbers are not being able to recognize as to what the way they have to be dealt with, right? So therefore, we have to use a statement called as in-format statement, which will help us read this non-standard data. So what is an in-format? The way you use it is, you specify the variable on which you want to apply. So that is DOJ in this case, right? And the type of in-format. So the type of in-format here is, see, it's in day, month, and year, right? DD, MM, YY, 8, 12. So here, DD, MM, YY is the name of the in-format. And this is the length. 8 is the length of it, and every format and in-format finish with a dot. Okay, they end with a period. Okay, so this is how an in-format statement looks like. So what exactly this does is, it says in-format DOJ in this form. So technically, we are not going to write a code wherein we decipher, wherein we write the whole algorithm to read a date value. Okay. The thing is, this is already there in the system. At the back end, this feature is already been programmed. All we have to do is, we have to invoke that feature.
Yeah.
Got it? And how are we going to invoke that feature of deciphering the date value is by using this particular function, DDMMYY. Here, what we call it as? We call it as an in-format. Okay? Yeah. Sai, you said something?
No, I'm fine.
Okay, great. So this is, so again, there are a lot of different types of in-formats. I will share a presentation with you which has got a list of them, of the frequently used and the important formats and in-formats. So, but you will get a hang of it as we keep, as the sessions continue. Okay, so date, for date, this is one of them. So in case if it is a month, day, and year value, then it would be MMDDYY.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it helps you read non-standard data into the system. Okay. Now that we have written this, let's just run the code and let's see if the problem is solved. So let's just select this and run it. Okay. Now let's see what's happened. Salary and date. What do I have here for date value? Can you see the date value here?
No.
But can you see certain numbers populated?
Yes.
Yeah. So, but here, like, a problem is halfway solved. So, any guess where these numbers, random numbers, are coming from?
No, actually, you said that they are separated by dot, right? But we did not change it in the code.
No, they are separated by dot. Every in-format ends with a dot. That we are doing, like, you know, after it we have put a dot, right? So yeah, see, what is happening here is, what the way dates are considered, see, for date, how it is programmed into a software is, there is a certain baseline date, okay, and the number of days are counted from that baseline date, okay? So in case of SAS, 1st of January 1960 is the starting date. Okay, so if you put 1st of January 1960 as the date of joining here, then you will see the value as 0 in place of this 19,766. So basically, 19,766 is the number of days from 1st of January 1960 in order to be 12th February 2014. Got an idea? So let me just change this date to 01 01 1960. Okay, I've just changed it. So now let's run this thing. Okay. So here you see the first value is 0. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So basically it starts counting from there, and these values are being populated as per the number of days from that starting value. Right? So now half the problem is solved. Why? Because now the system is understanding how to read these date values. But the output that it is giving, the user cannot use it. Right? I'm not able to understand what that 17,926 is. Right? I'm going to go crazy trying to decipher what date it is. So we have to do something else here. And that is using the format statement. The format is again used the same way as in format, but it's just that the name of the statement is different. That is format. DOJ again just here. EDMMYYA dot or whichever format you want to see it. So here let's just stick to the same thing. So these functionalities will be the same, be it format or in format. But this part here is going to decide whether it's going to read it or output it. Now let's see. Yeah. Can you see the date values now?
Yes.
Yeah. So now, yeah, fine. So if you go to DOJ here, you will see the data type is numeric.
Mm.
Yeah, and the format applied is DDMMYYA dot. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's say I want to add the date value as 1960, 2013, so on. So what will be the type of in format or format?
We'll be having four Ys.
That's an excellent guess. I mean, initially for the first time when I was learning, I expected the same, but SAS is a little funny. So here, the DDMMYY will remain the same. You will still have only two Ys, but the length will change. So the length earlier was 8, right? So it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But now it is 10. Right? So here, you just have to make it as 10 dot. Okay, so let's see. Yeah, so here we have the values. Year is the complete year value, the 4 digits. So that's about in format and format. So in format helps to read non-standard data into the system, and format. Okay. So that's about format and in format. So we'll do one more small change here. I would want you to have the salary values entered like this with a dollar symbol that's and a comma wherever relevant. So 7,890 dollars and let me just show you what exactly I want you to do. So now I've entered the current the salary value with the currency denotation, right? And the relevant comma separator. So let me just run this code. Oops. Yeah, so now if you see my salary value is missing.
Mm-hmm.
Why? It's a dot.
Same due to the same characters.
Exactly. So can you just work around? Can you just write a code in order to read this also? The name for this type of format or informat is dollar. And then you specify the length. Can you just try writing this in this code? I'll just share this code with you so that you can directly, I mean, or you can just use whatever code you're currently having. Just make a small change and see if you can work it out.
Where am I supposed to put this dollar statement?
You'll have the, so what did we do earlier? Like, we had a special character. We used what statement did we use?
First is in format.
Yes. So you can write it along with this, or you can write a separate in format statement after this.
Okay.
Or you can write along with this, whichever way you're comfortable. For the first time, you can always write a separate statement. You guys are able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, fine. No problem. Continue. Let me know once you're done.
I'm not getting it.
No problem. I just showed you. So what you can do is, you just need to return the in-format statement. So after in-format, what is the next thing we have to write is the variable.
Yeah.
Right? So that is salary. And then what is the type of in-format? Is dollar. The name of that is dollar, right? So dollar. What's the length? The maximum length is what we have to give. 1, 2, 3. 4, 5, 6. So including special character, 6. Okay, so let's just give it as 6 props. Similarly, you can give a format for it. You can do it in the same line. You can do the same thing with in format also. So after this, you can just write a variable name and then whatever is the information. Yeah, you see that?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's how you use informat and format statements. Okay. So that was about reading data into SAS using data lines. Okay, so that's a class. So you've seen how we use data lines in order to input the data. But as we discussed, the idea here was to understand more about the data types and what is format, informat, and some of the basic concepts like this. So going ahead, let's see. So this one is a data set that we have seen because we created data in this process, right? Let's take an example of a very simple proc step. Okay, so there are a lot of different proc steps. So what is a proc step? What is a proc step mostly used for? Sai?
Yeah.
So the way data step is mostly used for creating and manipulating data, proc step is generally used for
processing,
creating reports.
Generate reports.
Okay. Yeah. In order to generate reports, right? So let's see a simple proc step example, and that is the most simple of them all is proc print. So what does a proc print do? Is nothing but it will give you a print view of your data set. Okay, and let's see how that works. So let's say, suppose for it goes like this, proc print data equals. This is the syntax. It's always proc print data, and then you have an equal to sign. And after that, you specify the data set that you want to print. Let's say we want to print the same data set above, that is EMPDB, which is in work library. So I'm just going to write EMP_DB, the data set name. Okay, and nothing else, just write run. So this simple line of code will print, give us a print view of this data set, EMP_DB. So let's just run the code. Yeah, so here you have a print view of this. So here you see the result tab is populated.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is nothing but a print view of the data set. Similarly, you can try it out with some other data set also. Let's say there is this cars data set in session 1. Correct. Or let me use the data set which is there in SAS health. Okay. So under SAS health, there is a data set called as cars. Right. So if I want to do a proc print of this, how will I do? Proc print data equals. Can I just write cars? Will this work for me? No. Why? Because this cars is not there in work library. It is there in a permanent library, which is SAS health. Correct. So I have to write this library name first. That is SAS health. Dot, separated with a dot, and then specify the data set name, that is card. So let's just do run this code. So here in my results window, you will see the entire data set has been output onto this results window. So it is got 428 observations. Right, so I can scroll up and down. So this is what a simple proc print does. There are a lot of other options and statements that you can use in proc print, which we'll see going ahead. This is just an example of how a proc print code looks like. Okay, so now I want you to write a code. To print. Holiday data set from SAS health library. Can you just write a code for this? Mm-hmm. Everything is going to remain the same, just the data set in this time is going to change. Thank you.
I got it.
Okay, great.
Right,
got it?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah. So that's how a simple Proc Print works. Okay, so this will be pretty simple. It will be Proc Print data equals data set name. Okay, SAS dot is SAS dot holiday time. Okay. So here you have name, designation, category, beginning, end, month, day, rule, right? So here the data set is pretty small, okay? So you can see if I ask you a question as to how many observations are there in this data set?
27.
You can easily just, because it's very small, you can just scroll down and say it's 27. And how many variables are there in this data set? You can just, you know, because it's a small data set, you can just count them. How many variables are there?
9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
See, OBS is not a variable. It's just a numbering of the Proc Print. Okay?
Okay.
It's other than the OBS. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay? So it's pretty simple and easy here. Okay? Let's take an example of a complex data set. Okay? Let's say you have a data set of a bank's customer database. Right? And the attributes of the customers, like, you know, what is their current address, what are their PAN card details, what are their, other I card details, how, what are the different loans, FDs, RDs, and accounts they have, all these details in one particular file. So you can imagine how many observations and variables are going to be there, right? So when you have a, like, a larger data set, it will be great if you can use some procedure so that we just get the list of observations and variables, right? Mm-hmm. So even if it's a small data set, if I ask you a question, okay, in this how many are character variables, how many are numeric variables?
4 or
numeric. 3 are
3 are character, 4 are numeric, right? Not 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are numeric.
Yeah, 5.
Right? So even here it's a little tedious. Even here it will take some time for us, right? So we have a different procedure to do this job easy for us, and that is Proc contents. List the contents of a data set. So this will give you a lot of other information also to the content, but this is a very useful procedure in order to get a sense of what a particular data set contains. So I just say Proc contents again, data equals to SAS help dot holiday. Okay, so this is how your Proc contents code looks like. So let's just select this code and run it. So here you see this is the result of a contents code. The first table here is giving you the data set name, the member type, that is the data set, when was it created, when was it modified, and a lot of other intricate details of the system that it is running on. So we don't have to be worried about that now. We are not interested in all that. But what we are interested in is the number of observations. Can you see here?
Yeah.
It is listing out the number of observations, which is 27, the number of variables, which is 8. So these are things of an interest. And as you scroll down, here again is details about the machine and the host dependent information, which again we are not interested right now. This, the last table is again important. Arithmetic list of variables and attributes. So here it is just listing out which are the variables that are there, what is the data type of it, and what's the maximum length. Okay? So if you see, begin is numeric, category is character, day is numeric, in the description is character, end is numeric, month is numeric, name is numeric, name is character, role is numeric. Right? So this gives us the list of variables and observations. Basically, it gives us details of a particular data set. Okay? So that's about Proc content. But did you note something important here? These variables are not named serially. Can you see? like 4372568. Why are the name like that? Why are the number like that?
It's the order.
Yeah, it is an alphabetic list, right? So in your data set, name is coming first.
Yeah.
And description is coming second. Category is third. Beginning is fourth. But here the list is in alphabetic order of the variable name. Hence, these numbering has become haphazard. Okay. So before we continue with other options, can you just tell me how many variables and observations there in our data set? Can you answer this question?
Four, 28, and 15.
How do we do that? Proc Print data equals the library name. So when I run this code, I get the result. Observations are 428 and variables are 15.
15.
Okay, now out of these variables, how many are character, how many are numeric?
Five are character.
Yeah, five are character and obviously the remaining 10 are numeric.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that's how Proc Content becomes very useful in just getting an overview of the data set. So if you see, it has got further information because this data set is in sorted order. It says it is sorted by make and type variables. Okay, now coming back to Proc Content, as we have seen, the list of variables is in like alphabetic order, right? So it becomes a little difficult to visualize in the data set. They are different and here they are appearing in a different order. So if you want to view the list of variables in the same order as they are there in your data set, what you can do is you can use an option here. That is, the option is called as varnum. So when you use varnum option in your Proc Content, it will list the variables. Varnum lists the variables in creation order. That is, as they appear the data set. Okay, so that's what the varnum does. So it is varnum. This code, and you will see the list of variables path. Here you can see variables in creation order.
Yeah.
Yeah. So earlier it was alphabetic list of variables, and now it is variables in creation order. So varnum is an option that you can use in Proc Content. Similarly, there is another option here which is similar to varnum, that is called as position. Can you just run this code with position and tell me what will be the result and what does position do?
It is a Oh, it is showing displaying both of them in alphabetical order and in
So a position option, what it does is it will list out the list of variables in both alphabetic and variables in both alphabetic and creation order. So that's what you, that's how you can use a position option also with Proc Contents. Now I have the next question for you. So now Proc Contents is helping us get the details of what is like the broad structure of a data set, right? The structure of a data set obviously comprises of the number of observations, the types of variables, and the number of variables, correct? If I ask you a similar question, so can you tell me how many, files are there in a particular library? Okay, so let's say, so let's say like SAS Health has got so many data sets here, right? If I want to give me a count of it manually, it's not possible, right? Similarly, session one has got like at least 10-15 data sets. Work has got one data set, right? So if you want the information about the files which are there in a particular library, we can use Proc Contents for the same. And the way you do that is Proc Contents data equals. So just type the library name, for example, session one library, or let me use SAS Health itself, SAS Health dot. So after dot, don't specify the data set name. Okay, just specify underscore or underscore. What this does is it gives you, I accidentally signed out. Probably the problem. Can you just try that option? Just type in. Just type in Proc Contents data equals to SAS Health dot underscore all underscore semicolon and run after that. Oh my god. I didn't save it, I believe. Phew. Oh, guys, looks like we've lost some good amount of data. I will just type in one example for each for your reference here. But I hope it's clear. Yeah, did you run that code? What is the result?
Yes, I got so many tables.
Yeah, so basically it will do a Proc Contents for all the data sets that are there in that particular library. Right?
So it displays each individual data set.
Exactly. So I'll just tell you how you can simplify that result.
But your question was like how many data sets are there in a library, right?
Yeah, so as to get just the list of data sets that are there, you can do that. I'll just share it with you in a moment. So now, what we do is we just write this as underscore all underscore. So you know that it lists out all the tables of all the data sets that are there in this library. And then you say NODS, NODS, which is a short for no detail. So So when you write nodes with this, then it will just list out the files. So when I run this code, you will see it will just list out all the files that are there in this particular library. So here the first two tables are not required for us, but here, can you see the last table? It gives a list of all the files that are there. Right, so now you know you have got a total of 571 files. Yeah, similarly, you can do the same thing with your session also. Session one, session one dot.
Oh, sorry, I did not get what's the difference between with nodes and without nodes.
See, without nodes, you will get each and every table of each and every. Whereas with nodes, you will not get. See, if you look at the. See, can you see now? In my log, it is saying because my session got logged out and I logged in again, I'm getting an error that you know session one is not assigned. Yeah, so I'll have to rerun that libname statement in order to reassign it. Yeah, and only then will I be able to use it. Okay, now that it's assigned, I'm just scroll down and run this. So if you see here, it's just giving me the list of all the files that are there, right? If I don't use a node, then what will happen is it will give me the detailed content of like how many variables and observations are there in each of the files.
Yeah.
So that's the difference of, so here, can you see? So after this table of list of files, it is going to start with a detailed list. So that's how you use nods and underscore all underscore options with your proc contents. So that's about proc contents. So let's just take like an exactly 5 minute break and connect up again, okay? But exactly, let's just be back in 5 minutes, okay? Yeah. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, are we back? Sorry, you're there? Oh, I don't think the Sai is there yet. Let's just wait for a couple of minutes then. Sai, you're there?
Yeah.
So let's continue. So that was about Proc Print and Proc Contents. Okay, any doubts so far?
Yeah.
Okay. So going ahead from here, so this is just a sneak peek into what how a Proc Print looks, you know, how a Proc step looks like. So Proc Print also has got a lot of other statements that you can use in it, a lot of other options. We'll be seeing as we go ahead in the session, and but Proc Contents, we have covered all the important options that go with it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now coming to one of the very important parts, and that is INFILE. Okay, so INFILE is actually a way of reading raw data into SAS. Okay, reading. Or you can also call it as importing raw data into SAS, right? So for that, in order to know how to work around this, we'll also have to firstly understand what are the different types of files, okay? So as far as INFILE goes, we are talking about importing raw data, which what I mean by raw data is text files, okay? As far as CSV files, XLS files are concerned, you will see there are different types. You can use it. You can use a simple proc import to do that. Okay. So for that matter, we can just do with start off with proc import, importing data into SAS. Okay. And then we'll graduate to INFILE. Okay. So importing data is again done by a proc step, that is proc import. So obviously when you want to use some data in SAS, it has to be in SAS format, and to do that you will have to import it into SAS, right? So how do we do that is let's just take an example. Under my external files, I have some CSV files and XLX files. Right, so right, so let's just try a CSV file, fastdb.sample. Okay. So this is a CSV file. Let me take a simpler CSV for the sample data. I think it will be better. Okay, so this is a very simple CSV file that is there. And let's see how what we need to do in order to import this file into SAS. Yeah, any question?
No.
Okay. So what you need to do is it's simple. Proc import So when you write proc import, you will have to use data file equals. So you'll have to specify which is the file that you're trying to import. Am I right? So how do you do that? You'll have to go to your properties of this file and copy the path from there. So just 1 minute, just a second. So here's the path of this file with the file name. Let me just select it. For some reason I'm not able to select this again. Now I need to specify it in a location where I can read this file. So how do I do that? There's yeah. Here in quotes, but since it's a path, I have to specify it in quotes. Something is wrong with my quote symbol. So here I specify the path of the file that I'm trying to import, okay? And technically the entire other steps can be written in the same line, but since it becomes very lengthy, I'm going to write it in the next line, but hence I'm not giving a semicolon here, okay? It's basically the same line, I'm just splitting it across. And this is the file you will have to mention where do you want to output it. So out equal to the name of the file. So let's say we want to put it in work. So you can just put as sample import. Right? That's the name I get. And I have to also specify what is the BBMS type of it. So here it is a CSV file. So I give BBMS is equal to CSV. And just to make sure that if there's an existing file I want to overwrite it, I use replace option, replace statement. So technically, all these lines still replace the same line. Just for the ease of reading, I'm splitting it across. Okay, so you can write it like this. There's nothing wrong if you write it like this. It's the same thing. It's just so that it's easy for you to read. Okay. So let's see how this works for us. Yeah, so if you see now the particular file has been input into work, and under work you have sample underscore import, right? And this has got student ID, name and age. These are the three variables that are being imported, correct?
Okay, I have a question.
Yes.
I mean, what are you trying to do by importing from one library to the work library? Why is that?
We are not importing
library, right? Which is all.
See, the thing is, I'm not importing it from a library. I'm importing it from my external file. See, this is my servers and file folder, right? This is equivalent to importing something from my desktop.
I can't hear you.
One second. Is it clear? Hello. Sai, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Can you hear me, Anusha?
Now I can hear you.
Yeah, okay. So what I was saying is, this is equivalent to importing something from my D drive or from my desktop.
Okay.
The thing is, because I'm the server, I can't directly import it from my desktop.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. So this is the same thing which we discussed in the first session. I have uploaded whatever I want to use into this file, so it's a CSV file.
Mm-hmm.
From here, I'm importing it into my SAS library.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is like importing it from my D drive. Okay?
Yeah.
So if I have to do it, like if assuming I had SAS on my system and I'm not using SAS on demand for academics, then I could have written the path as something like, you know, C colon desktop slash slash sample data dot CSV. You know, I could have written like this.
Yeah.
But since
What's the sample input? Is it say temporary or permanent storage?
Okay, sample input now I've put it into temporary storage because I've not specified the data set library name. If I write session one dot, now it is permanent.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Session one dot. Okay. Let me just copy this bit again. Is it all clear, Anusha?
Yes.
It's basically same as like your, you know, picking up a data set, a file from an external drive. So similarly, can you import the XLX file that is there in the same location? Can you write a code to import the same sample underscore data, which is an XLX file?
Okay.
Can you try writing a code for that? So this XLX file right below that, just go copy from the properties, copy the path, and try and import that.
My laptop stuck. I cannot.
Oh, no problem. Don't worry. Just you can just restart it. Sai, you can try and let me know if you're done.
Yeah.
Oh, I think I got it now.
Can I import any file or any prescribed one?
You need to import sample underscore data dot XLSX. So under this, under the CSV, basically this is the same file which is stored as Excel.
Yeah, I got.
So I wanted to import the Excel file. So here we have seen an example of importing CSV file. Now we'll see how do we import an Excel file with that. So everything will remain the same, just the path will change a little, and your DBMS value will change.
I got an error. Okay.
It got an error.
Okay, just share screen, I'll just take a look, one second.
Oh, can you see my screen?
Oh, one second. Think my system is okay. Yeah. What does the error say? Okay. Go back to your code. Okay. See, it's an XLX file, so you have to write it as DBMS equal to XLX.
Yeah, I have done that. XLS.
XLS SX. It's the latest.
Okay.
XLS X. Huh. Yeah. Try now. Anusha, if you can share your screen.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, similarly, Anusha, even you have to make it as XLSX.
What if we have a no replacement? Every time is it necessary to do write a replace?
No, no. It is just, see, like in Excel or something, it will ask you to, do you want to overwrite it, right? Like in your Windows, if you copy paste a file from one folder to other folder, if there's the same file, if there's the same file already existing, it will ask, do you want to overwrite, correct?
Okay, yeah.
So that option is not there in SAS. It will not pop up and say, if you don't write replace, and just in case you have the data set with the same name, then it will not import at all. The import procedure will not work.
Okay.
Okay, it is just to make sure that it overwrites.
Okay.
Yeah?
It's,
is that
yeah.
clear?
Yeah.
Anusha, did you get it?
No, it says.
No, it is Excel SX. Go back to your code.
Okay, SX. Okay.
Yeah, SX. The same extension that is there with your data name. SX. Yeah. Now you run it.
It's still an error.
Physical file does not exist, it says. Go to your path that you have written. Go to your code.
Okay.
There's some problem with the code. So just right click and copy the path again. And paste it again. Yes, copy the path again and paste it.
I think just a slash is missing there.
Yeah, so just correct it accordingly.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's how you work on it. You use a proc import code to import a file. So the way you have seen, you can import an Excel, a CSV file called an Excel file using your proc import. Right? So here, if I want an XLX file, I'm just going to say, DNS. And if I want to save it in a permanent file, you know, just specify the permanent library, specify the path of it. So that's about importing a file, external file into SAS. There are a couple of other options also that you can use based on the type of file. So you will find that in the reading material that I'll be sharing. I'll share a PPT with you guys. So in that, you have a couple of other important options also. You can try that out on your own. Okay. So let's go ahead. So this is, we have seen how do we import a simple CSV or a Excel file into SAS. So let's say we want to import a text file, a raw data set, a raw file that looks something like this. So here are a list of my text files, which we'll be importing using INFILE. Okay. So if you see, I have test2.txt. So this is a text file. Right, I have this file here. Let me just show it to you in my folder as well, so that you get an idea as to how exactly it looks. Just a minute. Okay. Yeah. So can you see this text file? No, one second, I'll just change my sharing instructions. Okay, now can you see the text file?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is a text file that is there and I want to import this, okay? So since I don't have, since I can't access this text file directly from my system, I've uploaded it onto the server, that is all. Okay? So that's how these files look. So now before we go ahead with the code of trying to see how we can import this, we need to understand a certain basic thing. Like, what are the types of files, types of raw files? So in a text file, we have two types of files. One is a types of files, right? One is a fixed width file and the other is a delimited file. So what do you mean by a fixed width file? What do you understand by a fixed width file?
Might be the data cannot be edited, something like
that. Yeah, basically the data is of a fixed width, right? So let me just take an example. I'll just open a notepad here and I'll show it to you. Okay, so here if I have the values like this, name, age, city. Okay, so I have the name as Uma and let's say I have the age as 40 and I have city as Mumbai. Okay, and then let's say we have a value like Kiran and then I have age as 20 and I have city as Bangalore, right? And let's say we have something like Anusha, say we have these set of values. Okay, so if you see here, there is a certain fixed width for every variable. See, the value Uma has got only three characters, correct? But still there are certain, for example, the name has, the maximum length of name can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So this is a fixed width of, for this particular variable. Okay. Yeah? And the age can be, what maximum length of it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Similarly, city has got a fixed width. Getting it? So this is a fixed width file. A similar example, the same values can be a delimited file, which looks like this. So basically, it could be a space as a delimiter or comma as a delimiter. So in this case, if space is a delimiter, this is how your values will look like. Is it clear?
Yes.
Is the difference clear?
Yes.
So in a fixed width file, every variable has got a fixed length assigned to it. Right?
Yes.
And in case of a delimited file, there is a delimiter which will differentiate between variables. So in this case, the delimiter is space. The delimiter can be a slash, a comma, or whatever it is, a hyphen. But it should be the same across the file. Like, you can't have like this.
Yeah.
Right? So basically, this is a delimited file. Yeah? So these are the two types of files that we have. A fixed width file and a delimited file. Right? So once we understand this, then we'll see how we will be importing these two different types of files using INFILE. So let's just take an example of this text2 file. So first of all, is this a fixed width file or a delimited file?
Fixed width.
Yeah, it is a fixed width file, right? Because every variable here has got a fixed width assigned to it, right? So now we'll see how do we import it using INFILE. So how we do that is INFILE, again you'll be using a data step to do that. So data, you'll have to give the destination file. So destination file is the file that is being imported. So let me say, if I put in work library, let me say text file 1, okay? And then I have to specify the file, the path of the file. That is, from where is it going to be imported, right? So how do I do that? Then I say INFILE, right? And the path of the file. So for example, this is my file. I just go to properties of it and copy the path of it. Okay, so this is the in whatever you path you specify in the in file is the path from where you're going to import the file, right? And then you have to write your input statement the way we wrote for your data lines code. So here you'll be writing the input statement. Okay. So how does this input statement exactly work? Is by specifying the variables that we are trying to import into SAS, right? Mm-hmm. So here, if you see in this file, how many variables are there?
Four.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 variables, right? How many are character? How many are numeric?
2 numeric and 3 characters.
So there are 2 numeric and 3 characters. That's right. Yeah.
The third one is a combination of numeric.
Yeah, but then in that case, we will be using it as a character only. Because if there's even one character in it, you can't use it as a numeric, right? So
okay,
it will be a character type only. Alright, okay. So how this works is you specify the variable names here in your input statement. So let's say the first variable is okay. Just we'll just give some random names here. Let's say name one. Let's give product. Category, and then we'll say ID, product ID, and all the other values as stock order. Okay, so the first three are character. Hence, I have to use a dollar symbol for that, right? And the last row, numeric. So but only if I write this, it is not done. I'll have to specify the length because it is a fixed length. I'll have to specify the length of each one of them. Okay, so how do I specify the length of each one of them? Is by specifying, by determining how, what is the length. So what is the length of the first one? How do I know? I counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? And let's say 8 is the space. Okay, so 1, 2, 7 is my first value, right? So I'll say after this I'll give 1-7. And category is from where? So category 8 is not there. 9 10 11 12 13 14. So 7 to 14 9 to 14 is my category, right? 9 to 14. So then next one after 14, 15 is a space. 16 17 18 19 20, right? Mm-hmm. 16 to 20 is my third variable. 16 to 20. And the last two variables are 22, 23, and 25, 26, right? Mm-hmm. So this is 22 to 23, and this is 25. 26, right? So I specify the variables names along with the data type and the length of them, and then I say run. So what this code will do is it will pick up the file, the raw file from the path that is specified in the INFILE statement, right? And it will save it as text file 1. Since I have not specified a permanent library, it is saved in temporary library work. And when it reads this file, it knows these are the variables that it should name. And this is the length of them. Okay. So let's just run this code and see how this works. Yeah. Can you see? Mm-hmm. Broad category, product ID, stock and order. So a text file has got how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 observations. So here we have 6 observations. Is that clear?
I have a doubt actually.
Yeah. No?
In the first class, you accepted the same similar file, right? It was displaying in the same way. Now you have added the character length. I don't see any difference. Actually. It was in the same way, right? It will just pick
See, the difference is that we were using there to import, to write the data ourselves, right? The difference was in writing the data lines. Otherwise, there's no difference. You're right. Mm-hmm. The difference was in this part. So here we are not importing. We are just entering the data ourselves. That is all. Otherwise, this part, everything remains the same. Okay, here we are entering the data, we are not importing the data.
Oh, yeah.
Here, what we are doing is we are import. See, in this case, it's a very small file. In real time, when you work, you will be there, you don't have the problem of counting the way we counted. There, they will give you a file name, they will tell you how, what is the length of each variable that is there. Mm-hmm. So you can use that directly in the code. But the challenge there will be this file will have like millions of observations. And it would be having a minimum of 200 to 300 variables. Getting it? So you are going to use this way to import it.
And what happens if you don't write that thing?
Which part?
The numbers 1 to 7 and the space.
So there are different ways. We will see. Based on the different type of file, you can use it. So there are different ways of writing these lengths. So one of the method is this. So we will see there.
I'm like, what if you don't write the length? What happens?
Then see, for a fixed width file, you have to specify.
Okay.
If it's a delimited file, you don't have to.
Oh, okay.
So in the earlier example, like in the first class when we did these data lines, you notice it is a delimited file.
Mm-hmm.
You remember I have told you specifically that make sure you leave only one space.
Yes, yes.
Correct? So mm-hmm. that was the reason, because it's a delimited file.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right? Even here if you make it as a fixed width file, like even here you make sure you enter it like this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Here also you can make it a fixed width, correct?
Mm-hmm.
If I enter my file like this,
mm-hmm.
right? Now it becomes, even here in your input statement, you will have to specify the length.
Okay.
You're getting an idea?
Yes, yes.
So if I make my file like this, then this has to be a, even here in my input, I have to specify the length for each and every variable.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah?
Okay, I got it.
So this way it will write. Now this will become a fixed width file. Right? So that's the difference. So if you don't mention it, then yes, it is depending on the type of file you're dealing with.
Okay.
The fixed width you have, but now we'll also see the different ways. Here we have seen specifying from beginning to end, like, you know, starting position and the last position for each variable.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing can be done with a different operator. Okay. So let's say you don't want to write 1 to 7. The way you can do is you can use at the rate operator, specify the starting position at the rate 1
mm-hmm.
before the variable name, and here you specify the length of it as 7 dot.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So similarly, for the next one, what will it be?
At 9.
Yeah, so no, it will not be 14. What will it be? At the rate 9 is correct. What is the length of this?
Okay. 5.
So the length of this is, okay, so let me just cross check it again. It's 1, 2, 3, it's 6 totally, yeah. Six dot, right? And here it will be again at the rate 16. And the length will be
5.
Yeah. 5 dots. And at the rate 22. Two dots. At the rate 25. Again, the 2 dots. Yeah. So let's just run this. Let me just say 2, 1 underscore 1. Okay, let's see if this works fine. Yeah. Okay, so this also has imported the file properly. It's just that it's a different method. It's a way of using at the rate operator. So these become important from your certification standpoint also.
Mm-hmm.
This is called as a single at the rate operator. Yeah. So here we are seeing how do we reading fixed width file. Okay. And there is the third method of reading the same file using a plus operator. Yeah. How do we do that? Is then everything will remain the same, but the method in which you specify the length is going to differ. So here, what you do is you don't specify the length for the beginning and the that's the beginning length. So you don't specify at the rate 1 or at the rate 9 or anything. But you just specify the length of each variable. And you will specify the number of positions it has to move. What is meant by that? So here we are saying product is 7, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, it will assume it is starting from 1.
Mm-hmm.
So from 1, what it will do, it will start moving. Because it will move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Right? So here, I'm at the 7th position. Right? In order to reach the next variable, I have to move one more extra position. Mm-hmm. Right? And then I can start reading the next variable. So here, I use a plus pointer to say I have to move plus one position. Okay, after moving plus one position, I can read category for the next 6 characters. Again, I have to move how many? One position. So again, I do a plus one. And after that, I write 5. Again, I have to move one position. So I have a plus one everywhere. Plus one. And then plus one. So this is a plus operator. So let's just read this file. Yeah, so this also has successfully read this file. Right? So these are 3 different ways how you can read a fixed width file, either using a hyphen method with the starting and last position value, or using @ pointer, or using a plus operator. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this we have seen a very simple example of how do we read a text file. So we have seen how do we import test2 type of file. Mm-hmm. Right, so we have got some other files also. I'll just open and show the next file how it looks like test3 file. Can you see any difference between the test2 and test3 file? First of all, is it a fixed width or a delimited file?
It's a fixed width.
Test3 is a fixed, it's a fixed width file, correct? Mm-hmm. So first 2 are character, last 2 are numeric. There will be 4 characters, 4 variables. Okay? So what we'll do is with tomorrow's class, we'll see how we can import this using INFILE. Mm-hmm. Okay. In the meantime, this file, since it is already there here, you can just try. See, it is the same way. You can either use @ pointer, plus pointer, whichever you're comfortable, right? Just in case, everything will remain the same. Data, just give a file name. In file, just change test2 to test3. That is all. Okay? And in input, specify just 4 variables, A, B, C, D. Give any name. And based on whichever method you want to use, just put those pointers and see if you can import it. Okay, so that's a small task for tomorrow. Import test3.txt file using INFILE. Okay, just try it out. If you can, very good. Otherwise, we'll continue from here tomorrow. Okay, thank you guys. I'm sure it's quite late for you guys. Good night. See you tomorrow, same time. Okay?
Thank you.
Any doubts, we'll discuss tomorrow. Okay? Yeah. Bye-bye. Bye. Good night. Bye.